without microphone, is this okay? We have a microphone here, but I would prefer to speak without a microphone, okay? Seems to be fine. I was really surprised how many people registered, and first of all, we wanted to have a smaller workshop with 50 people or so, but then we saw so many people saying, could you please let us in? So we made a waiting list and tried to admit as many people in the waiting list as we could. Therefore, it's a bit crowded here, but otherwise you or your neighbor wouldn't be there, so please excuse this little inconvenience then. And another thing is, I still would like it to have an interactive workflow that you talk to each other and yeah, network, that would be very nice. I'm really, really glad to see how many people managed to install the Docker container. And last night I looked at it, and 16 out of 19 managed to install Docker. That's really great. But I guess some of them simply didn't register. And we need to provide a bit infrastructure for those who didn't install the Docker container. Who didn't manage to install the Docker container? It's only like so many people. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like 5 people. Okay, then that's really great. So we don't need extra resources from Amazon. We can provide internally. So it's, once again, it's only 5 people. Can you again raise the hands? Who did not manage to install the Docker container? Okay, that's only like, can you, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's really great. Good. A short look at the program before. If you install the Docker container not yesterday, but earlier than yesterday, you might need to install the latest version of the Docker image, it is called. Then you have to do the following command in Docker pull and reinstall it. And since it needs quite some network traffic, it would be nice if you do it during the presentation, so later on the network is free. Okay. The network, speaking of the network, the SSID of the network is event minus Z HRW. Yeah?
But when did you download the latest version?
I uploaded the latest version around like 10 minutes before I sent out the email yesterday, which was about 5 p.m.
Okay, so we did it after 5 o'clock yesterday.
That is good, you don't have to do anything.
I have time for two.
On two then? Yeah, I'm not. But it's not a problem. Speaking of the internet, you need, this is the SSID, and you need this password. And it might be that you have been on a conference earlier at the ZRHB, and then your network remembers this SSID and tries to connect, but the password changes, so you have to reset it, forget the network, and so on. Good. Maybe a short look at the program. I will try to give a short introduction to deep learning, and then there will be a tutorial on TensorFlow from Epi and Luciano from Google, and I'm really glad that they volunteered to do so. That's the gem, I think, of this whole event here, because we really get our hands dirty and really work with this code. I really appreciate this. And then in between there will be a lunch. You can take the lunch downtown, there at the Mensa area, but you could also break out, go to the city. We meet again, maybe at 1:15. And after that, there will be some talks about the applications of deep learning. Then there will be a poster session. The poster session will be on the same floor, just in the Mensa building, on the upper floor. Then there will be another talk about deep learning with Nine, a software framework. Then I will close shortly, and then there will be an upper row and on the upper area. We will serve coffee at the poster session, but if you want to have a snack in between, you just can go down. There's a little kiosk where you can buy snacks if you're running out of sugar or coffee. Good. That's actually it. For the program, just for interest, to get a bit an idea about the audience. Who has ever trained a neural network? Raise your hands. Okay, great. So very many. Who knows what is the ImageNet competition? Okay, so for most of them it's a bit boring. Actually, who has ever heard of backpropagation? Okay, that's not many. Who implemented backpropagation? I didn't do it. How about you? Okay. From scratch. Okay. So maybe that's for some of them it's a bit boring, but I still say something about deep learning maybe for them to catch up. Okay, good. What can we do with deep learning? And this is you have different APIs just from a high level perspective. You can have an image. This image has as input pixels, and you can say this image is a lion. You can have audio, do a spectrogram, and make a transcription. You can predict the probability that a certain person clicks on a document, or depending on the query, or you have two strings and you can translate from one language to another language. Or you can have even as input pixels and as output a string. All these things work now with deep learning systems. And I will focus on the first one, on ImageNet. On image classification, most of you know, it used to be a hard problem to really distinguish different images like 3 years or like 5 years ago. But now this is solved, and this is the story of the ImageNet competition. The ImageNet competition, for the one who doesn't know, maybe, is we have 1 million of samples, and these samples have 1,000 classes. And the task is to you get an image, and then you have to predict which class it is. Here you predict, you get the image is tiger, you know this, or you don't know this, but you have to predict it, and then you say, okay, I guess it's a tiger cat, a tabby, a boxer, or Sandermo, that you have 5 best guesses, and it's really a tiger, so you are correct. If you have this thing, and the ground truth is tape player, but your network say something like cellular phone, different things, you would have a misclassification. And up to 2011, roughly 1/3 of those images were misclassified wrongly. For a human person it's quite easy, for the machine it was really hard. And then came Alex Krzyzewski and handed in the first convolutional neural network, and the error dropped from 26%, I think, to 15%, nearly half the error. And then there was a change of paradigm. Everybody now is using these deep learning approaches. In the next year, just maybe one brave guy didn't try to do so. And it gets on and on. Then 2014, it was Google and Net which won the competition. 2015 was a big fight, and people get better now than human performance. The human performance is so bad because there are 170 dog breeds in the data set, so I couldn't tell them either. So. But still, they're getting close. If you look at this image net competition, this is the first Alex Krzyzewski net, this is the VGT60 net afterwards, or the Google net, this is the Inception net. These are all convolutional neural networks, and they're all based on an operation which is called convolution. That is the basic building block of these convolution things, and it's from the 90s, from the end of the 90s. And you're not only basing like ImageNet results here shown in blue, but you also have different architectures. You can do face detection using convolutional neural network. You can do a million of other things, even strange things like the deep dream thing or art style transfer. Or you can do like things, even things like reinforcement learning, like the AlphaGo system used, which beat Lisa Doll and Go in January, to use the convolutional neural network. Okay. So that's these convolutional neural networks. At the same time in the 90s, other important components for neural networks were discovered, like maybe a fully connected network, long short-term memory cells, all in the 90s. By the way, Schmidhuber, who invented and Hochreiter, who invented them, Schmidhuber is giving a talk tomorrow at the main conference. Okay, so this stuff is known from the 90s, and neural networks were very popular in the 90s. And then came other things like support vector machines or random forest, and they got a bit out of favor. And then 2012, nothing much really changed, but you had more data, you had more compute power, and you could then solve interesting problems, and right now, yeah, you really are becoming popular. Okay, what is then typical for these deep learning things? One thing is that you do a little or no feature engineering at all. Simply very little feature engineering. Maybe subtract the mean values or something. But you don't do really feature engineering. You basically use the raw data. And you learn an increasingly complex hierarchy of features. And also, What is also typically is that you have your systems are built out of simple components, simple building blocks called layers. And here are some of those layers shown below, and then you simply have to stick them together. And the third point, which I find very typically, is that you have a class is as an optimization problem. You have a loss function in which you try to minimize. You choose the parameters of your network so that the loss function is minimized. Good. Let's have a short look at, so it's the wrong one, at the architectures, the building blocks, boxes of these things. It's a bit like playing Lego, and so here you have all these things, and if you are a child, you build up these nice towers. Here you have all these convolutional stuff and these little components, and you stick them together, and you build something like, he built something like this ResNet, which one ImageNet competition last time. It's a bit like playing Lego, I think. And these are now typical examples of compositions building a deep learning architecture. This is a simple traditional neural network, a fully connected network. Here we have a convolutional network, which is also built of little units like the input. Then we have convolution units or layers. We have a max pooling layer, and we stack this all together. And at the very end, we have a final soft max network. Good. Let's have a look at the simple network, which is also known as a fully connected network, or sometimes also as a multi-layer perceptron. So here, this network is shown, and it's based a bit on the biological motivation. In the brain, you have these dendrites, and they are connected to other ones. You have incoming information, you have a body, and then you have another one. And somehow this gets translated into these networks. Then you, for example, have as input the first pixel, the gray value of the first pixel, the gray value of the second pixel. Then you connect these all together, then there's another layer coming, which is a hidden layer, takes all the input, produces output, and finally there's the final layer. But there are only three types of layer, the first layer set, and then this is one kind of layer, or one kind of building blocks applied two times, and this is the output layer. So let's look at these things individually. Let's look at one of those things here. This is the hidden layer. So this gets input from above and produces some output. And a bit like in the brain, you get input from, hopefully this is right, from the dendrites, they are the input, and then you collect the signals, and if the signals are higher than a certain threshold, this thing fires and puts it out to the axon. Okay. That's the biological motivation. How do we translate this to this machine learning, or to neural networks? Is we take the inputs, we multiply them with the weights. The stronger the weight, the stronger this input is. We sum them up, we add a constant, and then we get an intermediate value. And instead of firing, we have a nonlinear activation function, which simply takes this value set, produces of all these inputs, and then produces an output. And currently the most easy ones are so-called rectified linear unit. It simply produces set if the set is larger than zero, or zero otherwise if set is smaller than zero. That's actually all for a simple network. We just have to look at the final layer. And the final layer is done as follows. So here we have the input. And for example, this input belongs to a class which we know. And then we want to have, this is the input. And as the output, we want to have the probability that this input is, for example, Dejan or Diego. This is a face, by the way, people can't see this. So it has a probability of 0.3 that this is Dejan. How do we produce the probabilities out of those numbers, which arrive here? Here we sum up everything with the weights. Then we get a value set. We weight it to take the exponential of this value and normalize it so that this thing is between 0 and 1. And we have finished our first simple network. Okay. Why is this not the end of the story? Convolutional neural networks are better handling these things, and I just skim very shortly over them. If you want to have a more detailed description, you might look at this really great Stanford course given here. Okay, what's wrong with this fully connected layers with images? First of all, we have many weights. If you connect everything with everything, and we don't want to build deep architectures, we need too many weights, and that is not feasible. And one thing which is, for me, even more important, I think, is that you don't really take the problem into account. And images, they are local. So this is an image of Einstein, and maybe it's very important, this pixel and the neighboring pixel, they are correlated with each other. But this pixel and this pixel, they have nothing in common. So they don't need to get into the next layer somehow. And this is somehow wrong. What is also wrong is that this thing is not translational invariant. Or it's not translational invariant by design. If you move this guy by 2 pixels, it's still Einstein. But it's not coded into the network. Everything is connected with everything. And it's not translational invariant. And there's a remedy. These are these convolutional networks, or the building blocks. One is, they're consisting actually of 2 little operations. One is convolution and the other one is pooling. And I just describe them mechanically, what they do, and that they are really have nice properties. You have to look maybe at this Stanford course. So this is a convolutional neural network, and it's the same as the network which Lan and LeCun used in the 90s. You have an input. You have a convolutional layer. I described this, we don't know this yet. We have a pooling layer, we have another convolutional layer, a pooling layer, and then we have a fully connected network as we had before in our example, and then we have the softmax output layer giving the probabilities of these things. So now we have to understand this convolutional and the max pooling. The convolution is pretty simple. What it does, what is a convolution in mathematical sense? You have an input image, you have a convolution kernel, and you apply this on that input image, and if you say you take 0 times 40, 42 times 1, and you sum them all up, and you get out 42, of course. Okay. By the way, these are the weights of the convolutional neural network. They are not fixed, they are learned in the training process. I come back to the training in a second, okay? And then you take this kernel, and then you move it one position over, and then you get a new number. You simply move it over as shown in this diagram. You move the kernel, and this is your input image, and this is your output image, or after applying the convolution. This is actually this is typically called a feature map. Okay, let's see how this what the feature map actually produces. Say we have learned a kernel which looked like this, and that's somehow a typical kernel we might learn, and if we slide this over this image, we get an edge detector. Actually, we learn somehow these basic things can be learned using these convolutional layers. Okay. Good. So we stack it all together. We know now a bit mechanistically how these convolutional layers work. We don't only apply one filter; we apply a couple of filters, and then we make this pooling operation. This pooling operation simply reduces the size. And how does it work? It's that simple. You simply take the maximum value of, let's say, 4 pixels here. This is 20 in that case. Of these 4 pixels, that's 30, and so on. And it's so that simply that, and it works very well, that Hinton even complained that the pooling operation in convolutional networks is the big mistake. And the fact that it works so well is a disaster, because it's so unsatisfactory to have this thing working so perfectly. Okay. Good. Now we have everything. We could, if we knew this earlier, we could have won the ImageNet competition, or be the second place in the ImageNet competition 2014. Image, then 2 convolutional layers, having 3 times 3 the kernel size, having 64 of them, and so on. You stack them together, and you get a max pooling layer at the end, then you connect everything with everything, a fully connected layer separates, and then at the end you have the softmax layer giving the probability that this image belongs to a certain class. Okay. That's it for the architecture. You have now the building blocks, and you can stack them together and build nice systems. We didn't speak about training the network. Training the network is from a high perspective, if the network is a big complicated machine which has some parameters which have to be learned. In the case of the simple network, these parameters are the edges of the connections which you multiply, or in the case of the convolutional neural network, these parameters are the convolutional kernels which you slide, the weights of the convolutional filters you slide over the image. Okay, how do we do training? Okay, we have training examples from which we know the class, and we say, and this is the probability, the network, you take the training image, you feed it into the network, and you get, this is the output. And what is now a good way to measure the performance? If we have one training example, we take the log of the probability, or minus the log of the probability of that, of the right prediction of the training example. We know that training example is Oliver, then we take the log of it and take the minus, and that's the loss function. Why is this the loss function? Okay, let's make two examples. Let's say the network is perfect and has the probability to predict Oliver with probability 1. Then you have the log of 1, the log of 1 is 0, and the loss is 0. That's the best thing you could reach. Let's say the network is really, really bad and puts 0 probability on Oliver. Then you take the log of 0. The log of 0 is minus infinity. You multiply this minus, you have plus infinity. So plus infinity is the worst thing you could reach, and null is the optimal thing, and then you have simply an optimization function. Now you're trying to change this way to optimize this function, and you don't work on single examples. What you do, you take a couple of examples of your training deck. This is called a mini-batch in the jargon of neural networks. Then you calculate the loss function by simply summing up the losses of all the training examples, and then you have the loss function J. This loss function is typically referred to as cross entropy. Good. So you have the loss function, and then you update the parameters. And what you do is a very simple thing. You have about 1 million parameters. You cannot really draw it. But if you just take out one of the parameters of the 1 million parameters, you have a value theta prime of I, this is the value of the parameter, and then you calculate the gradient of the loss function, and then you simply go down a certain step size alpha and get the new value. This is called stochastic gradient descent. So the loss function is built from the mini batches you have in your training set, and then you take the derivative, and then you simply step down here to update your parameters. And all of the modern ways to optimize are somehow based on this little principle. There are a bit more clever ways to do it, like Adagrat or something, or Adam, but this is the principal thing, and that's called stochastic gradient descent. If you remember the numerics class or so, you might have heard about second order things. This is out of scope for a neural network, partly because we have so many parameters and you cannot really calculate the Hessian, the second order derivative here. Another note is that it's usually a non-convex function, and you still go downhill. But usually it's an empirical finding that it's not a problem that you have local minima. And actually I wrote down writing these things. You have a complicated network. I don't want to do this by hand, actually. And therefore, you have a framework, you have tools which do the work for you. And this has been done, for example, in Theano, or in TensorFlow is also doing it using AuthorDiff. And we heard more about this in a second. Okay, if you look at training, so you have, you usually take your training data where you have the labels, you split it in a training set, which you use to calculate your gradients and weights. You have a validation set that you kind of keep for online control, and then you have a test set which is very which you spare up till the very end. That's a typical way design. Then you look at the loss function of the training set. We start not at plus infinity, we may start at this random value, and then we optimize, and you see the loss function of the training set goes down. And if you have a complex enough network, we would finally reach zero. And by the way, this time axis is usually measured in, it's also a neural network speak, in epochs. An epoch is reached once you have each training example in your mini batch somehow once. Okay, so we finally go down to zero, but what happens with the validation is that you see that the error goes up, and this is now overfitting. You do an overfitting on the training set, but you don't generalize it to the validation set, and the error goes up. What you could do, the could stop here, that's called early stopping, or you could use other ways to fight this overfitting. One of them is, for example, dropout, which has been, which is a new development from 2012, I think, or 2013 maybe. Or you could do other things like, if you have images, you could do some augmentation, manipulation with the images, preserving the images. Okay, that was a kind of a verbal introduction to these deep learning things. Basically, I think what you have to keep in mind is that you have little building blocks you can put together, and you have an optimization problem, and you do first order derivatives, but you don't really have to do them. The tools do the work for you. I think we have now time for questions. I was fast again, I think. Yeah, any questions, or is it all clear? I mean, it's also somehow...
Something? Just curious. But you use mini-batches to train the network. Is this just for performance reasons, or there are other advantages, theoretically speaking?
First of all, this all the data has to be transferred. Usually you do this on a graphic card also, and they have limited memories up to 12 gigabytes. But I also think it has somehow a reason, because you introduce some noise using these mini-batches. If you would use all training data, the surface would always stay the same of this. If you use a mini-batch, it somehow fluctuates, and somehow, I don't know, this is somehow, I'm not sure if this is true, but I could imagine that if you're in a local minimum, a very small one, and then the surface changes a bit due to another mini-batch,
you
find
it
out, and then can find, you introduce some temperature, some noise, but that's, I'm not sure if this is true, but it's a good question. But it's not possible to have everything.
No, I was just speaking so theoretically. So if one could use all the data, the result would be the same or not.
I think, actually, if you could use all the data, there are also second derivative methods then, like it's called LBGDF, which would work. But I don't really know.
Do you have some experience in selecting the V-batch sums?
It should fit on the graphic card. That's actually, I think you, I don't know, you usually make them as big as you could somehow. Like, typical sizes are maybe like 128, depending on how much images you have or so. You have to fit the whole network several times on the graphic card, so it's usually quite small, around 100 or something like this.
Yeah, because larger image size,
yeah, you can do parallel, yeah. But on the other side, it cannot be arbitrarily large because then you're out of memory. And the extreme case, actually just using one, is also sometimes used. It's called stochastic gradient descent, but somehow it seems not to be so good, I think. One kind of experience you have to choose them randomly for mini batches. If you don't do this, you might run into problems, because if you have always the same mini batch, that's of course here. So?
You need to shuffle
between the things. That's for sure. Yeah. Other questions here?
Just out of curiosity, from your perspective, what's the difference between machine learning, deep learning, and artificial intelligence?
I mean, artificial intelligence, I don't know. Maybe you can also give the question back to the audience. Artificial intelligence, I mean, what that somehow, I don't know, goal for some people, or so to speak, though, that's general artificial intelligence is, I don't know, that's somehow a vision or something like this, I would say. Okay, machine learning is simply doing the hands-on work, and deep learning is the neural networks, they were like very hip in the 50s, then they went down, they went very up in the 90s, and you couldn't call them neural network again in 2010, I guess. You got a deep neural network. But of course they are a bit deep, but I think it's also a marketing term in a way, I think.
Does Google have
in-house... by the way, with these artificial intelligence, tomorrow, I'm not sure if you're here tomorrow, I think tomorrow is Schmidt who here, and he has more visionary ideas than I have, so to speak.
And the The general public is deeply confused about those three
limitations
because they appear and sometimes the same, sometimes different. So it's just
No, I don't touch this. Sorry. Yeah.
Because we have in-house a larger or deeper, like wider or deeper networks than Google and Learned, or this is kind of could be considered one.
I'm not from Google. I'm here lecture in this
okay.
thing, but maybe you can raise the question later or right now.
Yeah,
but
then could you?
If actually in-house or like in industry, deeper or wider networks than Google Learned are used. Or could be trained. Convolutional neural networks larger or deeper than Google Learned model.
If
they exist or they are used, or people could train. Could that be considered one of the widest or larger?
They're not used,
it's
not before
academic.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Architecture states, more or less, there are some new, but you have the basic building blocks, and they're from the 90s. That's a bit of a bold statement, but like in the first order, they are from the 90s, actually.
And
back propagation was also in the 90s? Back propagation was in the 90s, actually, yeah. And that was, I think, the first time in this, but I'm not so such an historian. I think the first time back propagation was used, let's see, here. They used backpropagation, the first time backpropagation was used, I'm not sure if it's the first time in normal network, but I think in this paper by Rummelhardt and Hinton or something like this. Backpropagation is nothing more than a chain rule, actually. This convolution architecture, they have been around earlier, I think like Fukushima invented, I'm not sure if he invented them, but they were not learned with backpropagation. And backpropagation was then done, I think, by Yannick Kuhn in the 80s. And also this long short-term memory things, they also introduced backpropagation in a clever way that backpropagation has an issue if you have many layers. You can have a problem called exploding gradient. And they implemented it a clever way.
But then what's really the new thing now?
What's the new thing? The new thing is that you make these things deeper, that you have more data, which is often underestimated.
Yeah, but deeper, so you could do this also with the previous architecture.
Yeah, but you wouldn't want to wait like 3 years. People didn't dare introduce.
No, I understand. You put more data and more power on it, but apart from this.
Mm-hmm. Apart from this, there are some little advanced things in the optimization, like for example, doing this batch normalization or doing fighting overfitting with dropout and stuff like this. There are some new inventions, but the basic units, they are... For not for all networks, but for most of the networks, they are the same basic units you had in the 90s. Yeah?
Your very last slide had a chart on it that intrigued me. You had
probably it's wrong.
No. There we go. So you've got your validation loss in red at the top, staying flat.
No, it's not the validation loss.
Your validation accuracy at the top, staying flat.
Yeah.
But your validation loss goes up. And I wondered, is that a normal phenomenon? Because I've been having this problem, is I never know when to do early stopping because the validation accuracy just goes flat. But then I wondered if showing loss would help me solve that.
I also experienced it quite a lot, and actually I don't start actually here. What you could do, you could also display the validation. You could simply wait until here or something like this, because the validation stays the same. I think it's a bit of the discrete nature, because validation, the loss is more sensitive, I mean.
Right.
The loss has a probabilities, and only if you flip to another probability and assign the wrong class, then the augmentation is somehow seen. Maybe this somehow heralds that there's something going wrong somehow, but it's not yet making it really, really wrong, but it's going in the wrong direction and having the wrong probability. But that's,
but you would do your early stopping on the accuracy rather than the loss in general.
I don't do all this stuff. But I don't know, maybe, but this is maybe, we can discuss these issues.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the great thing, having a workshop here, we can discuss these issues here. Actually, I never really did all this stuff. It's not at the end.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
The problem if you don't do early stopping is that it is no longer generalizable.
Yeah, sure.
And so it's just doing the overfitting, yes, it doesn't change the accuracy regarding the validation set, but if you apply it to some new data,
yeah,
it will be more off.
Yeah, that's true. But what I actually would do, that I would go here and then try techniques to prevent this overfitting.
Yeah.
Not stopping early is one of them. Other ones are like doing dropout and or increase your data set somehow with augmentation somehow. If you have an image, and this is the image of a hand, okay, label hand. This is still a hand. And this also, and if you rotate it, it's also still a hand, so you can augment your training data by doing some things. Yeah, some. Okay. I think we have time for like two more questions.
Well, I just have a comment, because with this loss and accuracy, I think in decision theory you use loss because that is a valid score.
Yeah.
And you really get the net so that it estimates the true probabilities. And if you use the accuracy, you somehow optimize the accuracy, but the probabilities are not really the best thing you can do. So if you go in decision theory, you see that in principle you should use the loss at this lot of probabilities, which is a valid thing, because you really optimize to estimate the true probabilities. And the other thing is like the wrong incentive. So you get a good accuracy, but still probabilities are not the true probabilities. So if you go to this statistical view, then I think the loss would be better.
And that's what you're optimizing for, actually.
For the minimum, right?
For the minimum, yeah.
Yeah,
okay. Then I think we switch maybe. And since it's a workshop, maybe you have the opportunity to talk to your neighbor you don't know for a second, and we switch gears to the tutorial then.